Hello, everyone. My name is Richard McSherry. I'm pastor of the Shaftsbury Methodist Church, and we're joining you once again from the sanctuary of the First Baptist Church on the corner of Valentine and Main here in downtown Bennington. And we're so glad that you could be with us at whatever time of the day or night you're joining us. We're so thankful that we can film this and can be shown in all different times of the day that hopefully will fit your schedule for those early birds and night owls alike. So welcome to the service today. As we gather together, let's turn to the Lord at this time and ask for his presence and his blessing. Gracious God, our Heavenly Father, we come to you this day with just overflowing joyful hearts. We thank you for your presence with us, and we just pray, Holy Spirit, that you'll be with us to guide and direct all that we say and do. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, at this time, Chris is going to come forward to open our service with our first hymn of praise.
The King of creation. Oh, my soul, praise him, for he is thy help and salvation. All ye who hear, now to his temple draw near. Join me in glad adoration. Praise to the Lord, who o'er all things so wondrously reigning, bears thee on eagle's wings, e'er in his keeping maintaining. God's care unfolds all who true good he upholds. Hast thou not known his sustaining? Praise to the Lord, who doth prosper thy work and defend thee. Surely his goodness and mercy here daily attend thee. Ponder anew what the Almighty can do, who with his love doth befriend thee. Praise to the Lord, who doth nourish thy life and restore thee, fitting thee well for the tasks that are ever before thee. Then to thy need God as a mother doth speed, spreading the wings of grace o'er thee. Praise to the Lord, oh, let all that is in me adore him. All that hath life and breath, come now with praises before him. Let the amen sound from his people again, gladly forever adore him.
At this time, Sue is coming forward, and we're going to continue our worship looking into God's word. And we'll be reading together Psalm 14 responsively. Psalm 14. This psalm, by the way, Psalm 91, is called the emergency psalm of the Old Testament because it's 911, whatever. But it is a wonderful psalm of God's protection and presence.
Okay, Psalm 91. Those who dwell in the shelter of the Most High, who abide in the shadow of the Almighty, will say to the Lord,
"My refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust."
For the Lord will deliver you from the snare of the fowler and from the deadly pestilence, and will cover you with his pinions.
Under the Lord's wings you will find refuge. God's faithfulness is a shield and a buckler.
You will not fear the terror of the night, nor the arrow that flies by day,
nor the pestilence that stalks at darkness, or the destruction that wastes at noonday.
1,000 may fall at your side, 10,000 at your right hand, but it will not come near you.
You will only look with your eyes and see the recompense of the wicked.
Because you have made the Lord your refuge, the Most High your habitation,
no evil will befall you, no scourge shall come near your tent.
For God will give his angels charge over you to guard you in all your ways.
They will bear you up on their hands, lest you dash your foot against a stone. You will tread on the lion and adder, the young lion and the serpent you will trample underfoot.
Because they cleave to me in love, I will deliver them.
I will protect them because they know my name.
When they call to me, I will answer them. I will be with them in trouble. I will rescue them and honor them.
I will satisfy them with long life and show them my salvation. Well, we come to the time of our service when we want to bring our our praises and thanksgiving and gratitude to the Lord. We want to have that attitude of gratitude to him for all that God has done, and also to bring our concerns and other things to the Lord as well. So let's turn to him, and at some point I'm going to pause and please urge you to just lift up whatever's on your heart, and then we'll conclude with the Lord's Prayer. Gracious God, we come to you this day on this beautiful day to thank you for your presence with us. We thank you that whatever time we may be watching this service, whether it's noon, midday, or midnight, whatever time, we know that you are with us. For you are beyond time, above time. We thank you, Lord, that you are God who never rests or sleeps, that you constantly watch over us to protect us and to guide us. We thank you that you are in our lives and in the lives of those we love. We thank you, God, for our nation and our world. We thank you for our friends and families and our neighbors, for all of those persons that you have put in our lives who make our lives richer and fuller and much more meaningful because of those who are in it. We ask a blessing on all of our loved ones, we pray this day. Lord, we're quite concerned. There are many areas of the world that are troubled. There are many difficulties and many struggles. We just pray, Lord, that you will just be present in all of those. We want to pray for those folks that we might know who are struggling with perhaps addiction or difficulties, lack of employment or underemployment, or seeking a new path, especially, Lord, today, huh? Those who are seeking a new path in this life. We want to pray for those who may be ill in body, whether it's cancer or Alzheimer's or whatever it might be, Parkinson's, Lord. So many things that can afflict a human person. We want to lift them up to you. For those who are lonely, those who are without friends, Lord, we pray that we can be that friend. So now, Lord, we want to pause to lift up those things which are in our hearts at this time. All of this we ask, Lord, in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen." This time, Chris is coming forward again to bring us another hymn of praise.
Grace of our loving Lord, grace that exceeds our sin and our guilt. Yonder on Calvary's mount outpoured, there where the blood of the Lamb was spilled. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all our sin. Sin and despair like the sea waves cold threaten the soul with infinite loss. Grace that is greater, yes, grace untold, points to the refuge, the mighty cross. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all our sin. Dark is the stain that we can not hide. What can avail to wash it away? Look, there is flowing a crimson tide, brighter than snow you may be today. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all our sin. Marvelous, infinite, matchless grace, freely bestowed on all who believe. You that are longing to see His face, will you this moment His grace receive? Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all our sin.
And now for some scripture readings, beginning with the Gospel according to Luke, chapter 16, verses 19 through 31. There was a rich man who was dressed in purple and fine linen, and who feasted sumptuously every day. And at his gate lay a poor man named Lazarus, covered with sores, who longed to satisfy his hunger with what fell from the rich man's table. Even the dogs would come and lick his sores. The poor man died and was carried away by the angels to be with Abraham. The rich man also died and was buried. In Hades, where he was being tormented, he looked up and saw Abraham far away with Lazarus by his side. He called out, Father Abraham, have mercy on me and send Lazarus to dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am in agony in these flames. But Abraham said, Child, remember that during your lifetime you received your good things, and Lazarus in like manner evil things. But now he is comforted here, and you are in agony. Besides all this, between you and us, a great chasm has been fixed, so that those who might want to pass from here to you cannot do so, and no one can pass from there to us. Then he said, Then, Father, I beg you to send him to my father's house, for I have five brothers, that he may warn them, so that they will not also come into this place of torment. Abraham replied, They have Moses and the prophets. They should listen to them. He said, No, Father Abraham, but if someone goes to them from the dead, they will repent. But Abraham said to him, If they do not listen to Moses and the prophets, neither will they be convinced, even if someone rises from the dead. And the reading from the New Testament is from Paul's first letter to Timothy, chapter 6, verses 6 through 19. Of course, there is great gain in godliness combined with contentment, for we brought nothing into the world so that we can take nothing out of it. But if we have food and clothing, we will be content with these. But those who want to be rich fall into temptation and are trapped by many senseless and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is a root to all kinds of evil, and in their eagerness to be rich, some have wandered away from the faith and pierced themselves with many pains. But as for you, man of God, shun all this. Pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, endurance, gentleness. Fight the good fight of the faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called and for which you made the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. In the presence of God, who gives life to all things, and of Christ Jesus, who in his testimony before Pontius Pilate made the good confession, I charge you to keep the commandment without spot or blame until the manifestation of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he will bring about at the right time, he who is the blessed and only sovereign, the King of kings and Lord of lords. It is he alone who has immortality and dwells in unapproachable light, whom no one has ever seen or can see. To him be honor and eternal dominion. Amen. As for those who, in the present age, are rich, command them not to be haughty or to set their hopes on the uncertainty of riches, but rather on God, who richly provides us with everything for our enjoyment. They are to do good, to be rich in good works, generous, and ready to share, thus storing up for themselves the treasure of a good foundation for the future, so that they may take hold of the life that really is life.
Let's pray. Gracious God, we have heard your wonderful word being read, and pray that you will bless it to us. May it take root in our lives, and may we be changed by it. Amen. Godly contentment. Godly contentment. That's what we heard about in our reading from Timothy today. Godliness combined with contentment may seem like a simple thing, right? But in reality, it's a very elusive goal. So many folks seem to be going through life constantly reaching out for that proverbial brass ring that's just beyond their fingertips, that ring which is just beyond the grasp of that person, that ring which is elusive at best. And for many, it seems like that they have more than they want, most and many, and yet they're unsatisfied. And they're constantly moving the goalposts forward. When they get this, they want that. When they get that, they want more. There's a story of a professional basketball player. His name was Scottie Pippen. He didn't have much as a boy. He grew up in a very poor family, a very small and crowded, cramped home with many people. But his journey into the NBA changed all of that. And from 1999 until 2002, his contract promised him at least $14.7 million a year, not counting endorsements from companies and sporting good companies and that sort of thing. Well, he owned a 70-foot-4 yacht and a $100,000 Mercedes. But somehow, even with all of that and the fame and the popularity, it didn't shield him from the negative effects of comparing himself to others. Isn't that funny? No matter where we are in life, whatever station we find ourselves in, and that may change over the years, so often we continue to compare ourselves to someone else, maybe someone we grew up with or someone we worked with or whatever it might be. A Sports Illustrated feature described how before every game at Portland's Rose Garden, Pippen would let his gaze drift over to the courtside seat that was occupied by one Paul Allen. He was the co-founder of Microsoft and owner of both the Trailblazers and the Seattle Seahawks. Now here was a man who at that time, we're talking 20 years ago, at that time had a personal net worth of $40 billion. Yes, billion with a B, a capital B. What does he have, Pippen asked himself, and then he would answer his own question, $40 billion, how can I make just $1 billion? Maybe he thought that sounded modest. $1 million. What do I need to do to accomplish that? And you know, the sad thing is that even if Pippen did get that $1 billion, you know, in the end, it wouldn't suffice. It wouldn't satisfy. No, then it would be $2 billion and three, and then he probably would ask himself, why not 40? If Paul Allen had it, why not me? Contentment doesn't come easy for so many. Less is never more, and more is never enough. Less is never more, and more is never enough. In Matthew 16, Jesus said, "For whoever desires to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. For what does it profit a man if he gains the whole world and then loses his own soul? Or what will a man give in exchange for his soul?" That's the theme of the parable we read in today's gospel, the story of that rich man who was dressed in purple and fine linen and feasted sumptuously every day. He had it made, or so he thought. You know, this being dressed in fine purple just sounds like a reference to a color. But in Jesus' day, the making of dyes to dye fabrics to become purple cloth was a very laborious and difficult task. And the fabrics were very, very costly indeed. And only the very elite of society could wear such garments. And so Jesus is giving us this picture of a man of great means and great wealth. Eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow never comes, does it? Well, for that man, tomorrow did come. And it wasn't what he expected at all. You know, Jesus told another parable regarding this in Luke chapter 12. There we read, Jesus said, "Take heed and beware of covetousness." You know, that's one of the commandments in the Ten Commandments, not coveting neighbor's goods and so forth. "For one's life does not consist in the abundance of the things he possesses." Then he spoke in a parable, saying, "The ground of a certain rich man yielded plentifully. And he thought to himself, 'What should I do, since I have no room to store my crops?' So he said, 'I'll do this. I'll pull down those barns. I'll tear them down. I'll bulldoze them. I'll just push them over the edge. And then I will build bigger barns. And there I will store all my crops and goods. And I will say to my soul, 'Soul, You have many goods laid up for many years. Take your ease. Eat, drink, and be merry. But God said to him, Fool, this very night your soul will be required of you. Then whose will these things be that you have provided? The man was blessed, to be sure. So blessed he didn't have room. Talk about abundance. Talk about the cup that overfloweth. He had so many things, and the harvest was, as Jesus said, abundant. But if we can infer from the parable, that man chose not to share his blessings with others. He simply built bigger barns, or at least he planned to store away the blessings that he had. You know, there's nothing wrong with abundance. There's nothing wrong with abundance if it is shared appropriately, if the attitude that you bring to that blessing of abundance is there. One of the most misquoted verses in Holy Scripture is that of 1 Timothy 6:10, for the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. Money is in of itself not evil. It's an inanimate object. It can't be evil in and of itself. How money is used, how blessings are used, determines whether they are evil or good. The scripture is clear. It's the love of money that is evil. So often we hear people say, money is the root of all evil. That's not what the Bible says. The Bible says the love of money is the root of all evil. That's where the problem is. How a thing is used determines its intrinsic value. That is what these two individuals miss in the parable of the master, and that is why so many miss it as well in their pursuit of anything except God. So many of our Lord's teachings have to do with priorities. What do we put first in our lives? I want to share a few statistics that say a lot about what we value, you and I, in our society today. Sports lovers, back to sports for a moment, coughed up some $33 billion for athletic equipment and $19 billion for gym membership over the past year. The average cost for a family of four to attend an NFL game is more than $500. So if a family of four wanted to go out and see a game and maybe stop on the way and have dinner or on the way home and have dinner, it would cost them $500 and then a few hundred more, probably pushing close to $1,000. In 2021, the average annual expenditure on cosmetics, perfume, and bath preparation products amounted to approximately $182.3 per customer unit, as this is expressed, in the U.S. The figure represents the highest in over a decade. In 2021, customers in the United States collectively spent nearly $2.45 billion on movie tickets, which is quite a surprise to many. It seems that movies have kind of fallen by the wayside, but apparently not at $2.45 billion. Surveyed dog owners in the U.S. spent an average of $442 on pet food in 2020. In comparison, cat owners claim to spend an average of $329 on pet food on an annual basis. And there are many other kinds of pets as well, fish and birds and all sorts of things. Now, please, please don't get me wrong here. Don't get me wrong. I'm not saying you shouldn't participate in sports events or take your family to sports events or even to stop going to the movies and certainly not stop using cosmetics and properly taking care of your pets. If God has entrusted you with a pet, then you should take care of that pet. What we need to ask ourselves is, however, what takes first place in our lives as followers of the Lord Jesus Christ? That is really what's being asked here. Often when speaking of giving, we hear of the threefold time and talent and treasure, right? Those are the things that we want to give to the Lord. A worthy portion to the work of the Lord. Time may be one of the hardest things to give, you know, money and monetary things aside when we think of what we give to the Lord. How do we spend each and every day in service to the Lord? How much time do we spend in prayer and in Bible reading? To share a couple of statistics again of how Americans utilize their time, consider the following. According to the Nielsen ratings, The average American watches more than 4 hours of television each day, or 28 hours per week, or 2 months nonstop per year. 2 months out of every year, out of 12 months, they spend in front of a television. And in a 65-year life, that person will have spent 9 of those years glued to the tube. 9 years of one's life. Americans spent an average of more than 1,300 hours on social media alone last year. That is a lot of time doing those things. So we need to ask ourselves, how much time do I spend in prayer? Prayer for my community, for friends, loved ones, prayer for the larger issues that are going on in the world. We have a very troubled world that needs a lot of prayer. And what about Bible study? Picking up God's word each and every day. And just as we feed our bodies, are we feeding our souls? And in service, how much service, how much time do I give in serving others in the name of Christ and helping where I can and using those gifts that God has given me in service? Watchman Nee once said, one gains by losing self for others, not by hoarding for ourselves. That's the losing of our life that Jesus talked about. It's not a literal losing, but a losing it to in the service of Christ and his kingdom. Really, as Christians, that is where we find joy. That joy that the Bible describes as our strength. The joy of the Lord is our strength. Heartfelt, meaningful joy. The kind of joy that only God can give. Paul admonishes us here, we should each and every day pursue a life of righteousness, of godliness, of focusing our thoughts and our lives on the things of God, especially as found in his word, of faith, which is trust in him, of trust, and of love, love for God, love for others, that twofold commandment that Jesus talked about, loving the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, strength, and mind, and your neighbor as yourself. Loving God and serving others. Endurance, fighting the good fight, staying true to the course. Paul often used athletic analogies of running a race, staying true to that goal. And of gentleness. We live in an angry world today, a very angry world. People have difficulty even talking to others. We need to be examples of gentleness and kindness to those around us. And you know, in this way, we will witness the transformation, not only of ourselves, which will definitely happen, but ultimately of the world around us as well. Paul spoke of those who set their hopes on the uncertainty of riches. The reality is that all things fade, all things wear out, all material things are transitory. There was a story told in late 1929 of a group of Americans who boarded a ship in Great Britain, and they sailed for home. They sailed for New York. When they stepped onto that ship, most of them were multimillionaires. They traveled the world. They saw everything there was to see. They led great and beautiful and full lives. When they stepped off that boat in November of 1929, many of them were paupers. The stock market had crashed while they were in the middle of the Atlantic. They left Great Britain as millionaires. They stepped foot in New York as paupers. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God stands forever. The prophet Isaiah reminds us. God has created a beautiful world, an incredible universe, for his glory and our well-being and enjoyment. We, in turn, have been called to rely on God, who richly provides us with everything, everything for our enjoyment. As someone reminds us, how easy it is for us to lose sight of God's truth when there are bright and shiny toys dangled in front of us. The love of money and what we think we can gain from it has this crazy effective way of pulling the wool over our eyes and distorting what we know to be true. Throughout Scripture, for instance, we're reminded that the unrighteous are just as likely as the righteous to receive the bounty and possess the blessings of the earth. You know, the Bible says rain falls on the just and the unjust. And that rain isn't how we think of it in this part of the world. Rain is always seen in the Bible as a blessing. Always seen as a blessing. But we want it to mean something special about ourselves. We earned it. We hustled for it. We made it happen. And we deserved it. God's gift to us for our obedience. We made God happy, so God is making us happy. But the real truth is, the profound truth is, that bounty is part of God's nature, along with the expectation that his people will share with one another if there is a need. Contentment that is paired with trusting God, one without worry or hustle for gain, gets us closer to the picture of that life that really is life. Isn't that a wonderful expression? The life that really is life. Than any of the lies we tell ourselves to justify what we're doing, to gain what we can in order to have what we want. In that head and heart space, even godliness becomes a means to an end, rather than the end result of a life transformed by the presence of the risen living Christ in our hearts. What this simply means is placing all that we have in the hands of the one who loves us, the Lord Jesus Christ. The 16th century reformer Martin Luther once said, "I have held many things in my hands. I've held many things in my hands, and I have lost them all. But whatever I have placed in God's hands, that I still possess." We will find that joy is in the Lord and in the things of the Lord, those intangible things that are without cost or price. And we will discover, as Charles Spurgeon did, that it's not how much we have, but how much we enjoy that brings happiness. And it begins with a re-evaluation of priorities, of looking at things as the Lord sees them. It's an adjustment of our attitudes, of our heart, and of our minds toward those things of God. I'd like to close today with a thought from pastor and prolific writer Charles Swindoll. He once said, "The longer I live, the more I realize the impact of attitude on life. Attitude is more important than facts. It's more important than the past or education, money, circumstances, failures, and successes, than what other people think, say, or do. It is more important than appearance, giftedness, or skill. Attitude will make or break a company, a church, or a home. The remarkable thing is that we have a choice each and every day regarding the attitude we embrace for that day. We can't change the past. We cannot change the fact that people will act in a certain way. We cannot change the inevitable. The only thing we can do is play the one string we have, and that's our attitude." Swindoll concludes by saying, "I am convinced that life is 10% of what happens to me and 90% how I react to it. And so it is with you. We are in charge of our attitudes." Amen. Let's pray. Gracious God, help us to reassess those attitudes that we have. May they be your attitudes. May they be godly attitudes. May they be scripture-based attitudes. Help us, Lord, to grow closer to you each and every day, closer to one another, and closer to that day when we are reunited in your love and care. Amen. At this time, Chris will come forward to send us off with our final word of praise.
Christ her Lord, she is his new creation by water and the word. From heaven he came and sought her to be his holy bride. With his own blood he bought her, and for her life he died. Elect from every nation. nation yet one o'er all the earth. Her charter of salvation, one Lord, one faith, one birth. One holy name she blesses, partake one holy food, and to one hope she presses with every grace endued. Though with a scornful wonder we see her sore oppressed, by chisms rent asunder, by heresies distressed, yet saints their watch are keeping, their cry goes up how long, and soon the night of weeping shall be the morn of song. Mid toil and tribulation and tumult of her war, she waits the consummation of peace forevermore, till with the vision glorious her longing eyes are blessed, and the great church victorious shall be the church at rest. Yet she on earth hath union with God the three in one, and mystic sweet communion with those whose rest is won. Oh, happy ones and holy Lord, give us grace that we, like them the meek and lowly, on high may dwell with thee.
Well, we hope the service was a blessing to you today. If you are able, Sundays at 127 Church Street in Shaftsbury, you may join us there. I'm sure a warm welcome will await you. Let's pray for God's blessing as we depart. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift his countenance upon you and grant you his peace, even that peace which passes all understanding, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.